Wait a minute.
Last year, Stan asked me if I would be interested in doing a program on the society's collection of Maud Farwell's diaries. My answer was an easy yes, because not only my being a newcomer to Bethel, I thought it would be a nice way to learn something about the community, but I'm also very aware of the importance of diaries. History texts can give us all the facts, and they can provide some interpretations for us, but the diaries give us a special insight into the everyday lives and events of individuals. Even very brief descriptions of a day's events, such as the Farwell diaries, can give us a wealth of information, particularly when they cover as long a period as Maud Farwell diaries did. Unfortunately, historians more and more are regarding diaries as treasure troves because they do provide a human touch, a bit of flavor, if you will, to our overall understanding and knowledge of what is happening. Diaries have been kept by many American women, probably since before the beginning of the Revolutionary War, and women from almost every segment of American society, with the major exception of the black female slave, have kept written records of their daily lives and experiences. Women such as Abigail Adams, Louisa May Alcott, Anne Morrow Lindbergh, Mary Chestnut, May Sarton are among some of the well-known women who have kept diaries or journals which have been published and are familiar to most of us. But for the most part, diaries have been written about ordinary, by ordinary women, about ordinary events. Even though women have been keeping diaries for many years, men have always been the major journal keepers until well into the middle of the 19th century. This is probably due to the fact that it's only in the past 100 years or so that diaries have been considered a private record. In her book, A Day at a Time, the editor, Margot Cully, tells us that many 18th and 19th century diaries were semi-public documents that were obviously intended to be read by an audience, especially men's diaries, which were apt to be a record of a public life. However, with the advent of the Industrial Revolution and the introduction of Romanticism, the function and contents of diaries changed drastically. The idea of a more secular diary emerged in which it was acceptable to examine and reflect upon an inner life. And women were permitted and encouraged, in fact, to do so. Diary writing was considered an accomplishment for a well-bred young lady. And a line-a-day type book, which is what Maud Farwell's basically are, was a popular gift. And therefore, women became the predominant diarists and recorders of family and community history. Before I get into the diaries of Maud Farwell, I'd like, we do have a few slides that are pictures of her and her family, so you have a little bit of an idea of just who we're talking about. These are her two children. The little girl is Marjorie. The baby is Andrew, who died in 1909 of diphtheria. This is their house, which is over on the corner of Elm Street and Railroad Street. It's Barbara Leland Brown's hometown, Farwell Inn. And that is where Shoveling Snow. There's where Shoveling Snow again. The house looks a lot nicer today. And this is the Farwell family. This is Maud here. This is Marjorie. This is Bert in the background. These are Barbara's reproductions of pictures that Barbara several copies made up for friends and families and family members, and she kept mentioning in her diary that Thursday was the day the pictures were due back, so, and it's a nice picture.
Is that one of yours, Don?
No.
No, no?
She said she had taken care of town, but I...
Oh, maybe Laura's wallet.
I think it was.
She liked that one when she showed it, it was a nice picture. The Diaries of Maud Farwell, belonging to the Historical Society, began on January 1st, 1935, and end with her death in 1964. And no, I'm not reading every diary tonight. I don't know if she kept the diary before this time. I suspect that in 1935 it was the beginning of it, and that it was a gift from her daughter Marjorie, as were the ones for the following years, because one year her diary didn't start until late in January, and Marjorie apparently forgot, which her mother promptly recorded. Maud was born in Paris, and I call her Maud, and I call him Mert, simply because after reading all of this, I really feel that I know them very well. Maud Farwell was born in Paris, Maine, on October 17, 1872. She was the daughter of Llewellyn and Pauline Murdoch, and she moved to Bethel in 1890. She married Henry Merton Farwell on May 2, 1899, and they had two children, Marjorie, who was born in 1903, and a second child, Andrew, who died in 1909 of diphtheria, which pictured the baby. The Farwells lived on the corner of Elm Street and Railroad Street in what is now the Farwell House, the B&B owned by Leland and Barbara Brown. In her diary, she has a cast of characters who keep coming up page after page, and the main cast consists of the following: the children, who were her daughter Marjorie and her first husband Stanley Bartlett. They lived in Lewiston. Her Bethel friends and neighbors, Harry Jordan, Cora Bean, Maybelle Knapp, Jenny and Mildred Basterman, Grace and George Thompson, Emma and Val Van den Kirkhoven, no, it was Al Van, Catherine and Cal Bailey, Alice Rowe, Marie and Guard Brown, Ethel Penley and Clara Berry of West Paris, and Ada Swan of Bryant Pond. The Thursday night whist group was made up of Merck, Al Van, Dr. Tibbetts, and Professor Hanscom of Rule Academy. These four men met every Tuesday night at each other's homes for many years on a rotating basis, and it had to be the highlight of their weeks, and she recorded every night that Merck won. The diaries look like this. So you see they're not very big, and the entries are all about like that. I'd like to read you a few. Again, not every one, but at the beginning of it, to give you a little bit of the flavor of what she was saying. Tuesday, January 1st, 1935, this is her first entry. Snowed all day hard, about 15 inches fell. About 30 inches had fallen in the past week. Quite cold, wind began about 9 o'clock. I've been sewing on my Christmas dress. Listened to the Stanford versus Alabama football game on the radio. Alabama won, reception perfect. Well, some things haven't changed. Wednesday, January 3rd, cold, windy, snow drifted all day. Trains and autos got through, though late. January 7th, a warm spring-like day. Snow thawed a lot, foggy at night. Mert painted the edges of the floor. This was the second coat. Lindbergh versus Huffman trial, a big feature on radio. Wednesday, January 9th, rained all day, road slushy, still raining 9:30 p.m., embroidered Rosalie sleeves for 50 cents. January 12th, a cold day with some wind. Children came about 8 p.m. We put the new rug in the kitchen. Not a hard job, we had dreaded it. We had a good time putting the puzzle together. January 15th, a clear, still day. I called at Grace's. Mert played cards at Hanscom's and won. 8 below 0 before he left for home. As you can see, each entry has some comment on the weather. And that's consistent throughout all the years she kept her diaries. Every day there was a comment. Well, weather, of course, is important to us, and I'm sure when it wasn't as convenient living, it had to be for them. It's been said that one can track years of New England weather patterns just by reading all the diaries. In fact, I think there have been studies done. And Maud's are no exception. Each entry, as I said, had a reference to the weather. She lists the snowfall totals from 1933 to 1939 by year. She started on 1st of November and ended at the end of March. 1934, 89.5 inches. 1935, 98.5 inches. 1936, 92 inches. 1937, 58 inches. 38, 56, 39, 100. I keep hearing that our main winters aren't the same as they used to be, but I wonder about this. The early years of Maud's diaries take place during the depths of the Depression, and Bethel must have suffered as much as the rest of the nation. However, there's no mention of the Depression at all. Mert worked the dowel mill, apparently on an on-call basis, and Maud took in sewing. They led an active, busy life. They visited friends, invited them to dinner, were invited back in return. Club meetings every Thursday for Maud, connected with the church, church every Sunday. They attended the Congregational Church, but weren't members until January of 1949, when Maud writes, "United with the Congregational Church, along with 57 other people, including Hattie Hall and Ada Durrell, a reception was held for the new members, all former Universalists." Maud was really a church member. When Mert went, it was noted. She went every Sunday just about, but Mert was not as good. A great deal of her time was spent in letter writing. It was amazing the letters that she wrote and the letters she received. She read a great deal. And of course, the daily routines of keeping house. Keeping house was more than just a notion in 1935. She did her laundry every Monday by hand and hung it outdoors in the summer and on the porch in the winter. Ironing was done on Tuesday if things had dried the day before. Friday was for cleaning and dusting the house. May was the time for spring cleaning, and she reports her cleaning activities for the spring of 1935. On May 9th, cleaned up the bathroom and the little bedroom, washed all the curtains and all the bedding. May 10th, all day cleaning. May 11th, cleaned other bedrooms, aired all the bedding. Bert put on the downstairs screen. May 13th, finished cleaning back bedroom, cleaned kitchen bureau drawers, washed porch windows, began cleaning downstairs chambers. She was 63 at this time. This in addition to sewing for others and keeping a garden. She kept up the strenuous cleaning schedule until 1943, when at the age of 71, she was hospitalized twice for what the doctor concluded was exhaustion. She was told to stop working so hard, eat more, take vitamins, and take a 2-hour nap every afternoon. Her diaries don't indicate that she ever followed that at all. Incidentally, one of her housekeeping routines, which I thought was very interesting, at the end of April, she turned on her refrigerator, and the end of November, she turned it off. Thrifty. They walked about just about everywhere in town, although they did own an automobile, and in fact, they took a lot of car trips. They went regularly to Lewiston and regularly to Rumford. So they did use their car. She didn't drive, Mert did all the driving. On April 5th, they started, or 35, they started for Lewiston about 4:30. Went to see Roberta, very good, roads in good condition. I'm sure that was a consideration. April 6th, they obviously spent the weekend with Marjorie, had a quiet morning at Marjorie's, had a lobster dinner. Lobster had to be a treat, because every time she had it, she mentioned it and commented on how good it was. We got home at 6 p.m. The children arrived from Lewiston about 7. We went to the pictures with the Thompsons in the evenings. This is two movies in 2 days. Enjoyed our visit. They really enjoyed going to the movies, and I have a picture of the Bethel Theater that day, because at that time, which I want you to see, she loved movies. This is the new Bethel Theater. She recorded every movie she saw, whether she liked it or not. Whether she liked it or not. She seemed to like most of them. For some reason, she had it in for so many movies. Didn't like any of them. On August 11th, 1940, she noted with pleasure that a modern movie theater is to be built on the lot next to Sanborn's. Work begins today. On December 18th, she writes, "Emma went with us to the Bethel Theater opening. Theater is very nice. Show is good. House full." And for the trivia buffs, movie was South of Suez. Anybody remember that one? Summertime was a very busy time for the Farwells. In addition to their regular chores, they had a good-sized garden, both perennial and vegetables. Their vegetable garden required a great deal of time during the summer, during the growing season. It produced their food for the summer, of course, but also for the winter, which meant everything had to be put up. However, they still found time to take extended car trips, go to the lake on fishing trips. On September 21st, she reports, "A good day at the lake. We caught 10 salmon and 4 trout in all." They attended baseball games. Mert is a fan. He often went over to Berlin to watch games. They listened to them on the radio, and even Mert, Maud, listened to all the World Series games. 1936 was an election year, and the campaigning apparently started early in January, because on January 25th of 1936, Maud says, "This afternoon I went up to Maybell's to work on costumes. We listened to Al Smith's speech at the Liberty League dinner, a very plain, sensible talk." On November 3rd, election day came around, and her diary reads, "We voted for Landon, got home about 9 a.m. At 10:30 p.m., we were quite sure Roosevelt was elected and went to bed." November 4th, a great victory for Roosevelt. Only 2 states went for Landon, Maine and Vermont. We were surprised and disappointed. Have sewed almost all day and it rained hard. This was obviously when as Maine goes, so goes the nation, turned to us when as Maine goes, so goes Vermont. She did remain loyal to the Republican Party, however, and in August 1940, her diary reads, "Mr. Russell called to ask me to solicit funds for the Wilkie campaign from Elm Street and High Street. I didn't want to do this, but I said I would." On August 12th, "Finished up soliciting for Mr. Wilkie, got $2 from him." Probably that's why Mr. Wilkie didn't. Big story in Bethel, however, in 1936 was the flooding that occurred in March. Maud reported it all beginning on March 11th. And I thought I would read a section from these diaries, this particular aspect of her diaries, because I thought they were interesting and something you probably remember. March 11th, cloudy, beginning to rain in the afternoon. March 12th, rained hard all day. Flood conditions over New England and other states. Water over the road at Swan's Corner. Mert couldn't get home. Mr. K couldn't get home, and Mrs. Knapp stayed all night in the bus. Cars were going over the bridge all evening, fearing ice might jam and cause trouble. March 13th, thunder shower in the night. Steam mill and all the river roads impassable on account of the water in the morning. Mr. Knapp got home this morning. Much damage done in many places by high water. No school. Children, students, and others going to see the high water at the bridge. Conditions a little better at night. March 14th, 15th, and 16th were cloudy, but no rain. Then on the 17th, she writes, "A dull, foggy day, raining by evening." March 18th, still raining. Water rose fast through the day. Mert and I went over to the bridge about 6 p.m. and lots of people were over there. Ice went out soon after we left, and waters over Mill Link Bridge and Alder River becoming impassable before noon. Mr. Knapp only went to Swan's Corner. Rained all evening and night, I think. Several families vacated their homes. March 19th, very high water this morning. Ice about 4 feet from the framework of Big Bridge. The jams near John Anderson's and above the cemetery made people fear it might hurt that little bridge. Ice did go out near the bridge in the early evening, breaking telephone poles and trees. Water surrounded the Marshall House in early morning, rising constantly until noon. At 5 p.m., it had risen from 6 to 8 inches. Water was up to the second story window of Mrs. Howe's house, the doorknob at Allen Morgan's. Bethel Inn Farm was isolated. Boats went there from Dudley Hill. His horses and several steers were made to swim across. 6 cows left. Roy Blake took his milk across by motorboat Thursday afternoon, and trains were stopped at Shelburne. Freight trains had been here since Wednesday. No trains through Thursday. governor appealed for contributions to the Red Cross over the radio Friday night. Old Toll Bridge at Rumford went out. March 21st, dull morning, heavy rain all afternoon. Men and trucks working repairing road, but the Boston mail came through late in the afternoon. Conditions very bad all day. Airplanes had been over this locality. This is 1936, that must have been the site. March 22nd, rained all day. Water on roads again, no church service, drinking water supply from other places. Red Cross, Legion, and Salvation Army working. Temporary telephone lines put through. On March 23rd, it finally stopped, clear and colder. The stock at Saunders Mill scattered all around. The fields at Swan's Corner are covered with mud. Fences full of leaves, grass, and stuff washed on them. We think it will be a long time before things are cleaned up. And she ended her account of the floods with this notation. Saw a robin this morning. You have a few slides. I'm sure they're familiar to a lot of you, but this is a good place to show them. I think this is East Bethel. I'm correct you on this. There's some flooding there. And this is the flat road out of West Bethel. And water all looked like that this week, too, almost.
That's pretty flat.
This is Bridge Street. Water. And this is the Alder River. Something coming through and all the water. So that was quite an event. Thank you, Randy. That's on one of your slides. She mentioned she saw a robin this morning. She often mentions the birds. She really seemed to love them. She regularly reported the activities of the birds on her feeder, what new ones were in her yard, when the robins returned, where nests were being built, and by whom. It was important. In 1937, tragedy struck the family. Marjorie's husband, Stanley, became seriously ill in early June. He had had surgery for a brain tumor 2 years earlier, but the severe headaches had apparently returned, and doctors in Lewiston tried surgery one more time. He never recovered from this operation and he died on July 13th. Marjorie had to give up their apartment, find a job, the Lewiston physician, and move into a rooming house in Lewiston. One thing that struck me when I read Maud's account of Stanley's death was the very matter-of-fact way she wrote. This had to be a terrible experience for the whole family. And her only statement was that, I cannot believe this has happened. This matter-of-factness and lack of emotion was very common throughout her diary, whether this was her personality or whether she was a very private person, it's hard to say. Certainly a contrast from some of the diaries that you read today, which explore every feeling, including something I don't want to know about. On a happier note, Maud wrote in early June that, today I went to work at the library for the very first time. I think I shall enjoy it. And she did enjoy it. She stayed there until 1953. By 1939, she's very much involved in working at the library. She basically stopped sewing for pay. What sewing she did was mostly for Marjorie. Marjorie, at this point, was living and working in Lewiston and had developed a very active social life, came home every weekend. In May of 1939, Maud and Mert celebrated their 40th anniversary. Maud writes, our 40th anniversary, Mert gave me a dozen lovely red roses. As I read that entry, I thought, what a grand gesture for the middle of the Depression. And I wonder, where did he get the roses in May, early May in Bethel? On Sunday, May 14th, in 39, they drove to Norway to take Marjorie's friend Bea to church. And Maud writes, we stopped at Ripley and Fletcher on our way home, came home with a new car. I didn't say how much she paid for it. Marjorie has been urging us to have one. Think we shall enjoy it. We're going to New York to the World's Fair with Beatrice and with Marjorie. And they did go, leaving Bethel on June 11th and returning on the 16th. They took their new car, they stayed at a hotel in New York City, ate at Childs, went to Radio City Music Hall, Statue of Liberty, hit the whole town up, and went, of course, to the fair. She visited as many of the exhibits as they could, wrote, they were all interesting and enjoyable. However, she made no comment on anything she actually saw, with the exception of the following. There was an old depot wagon from the Philbrook Farm in Shelburne, New Hampshire. We were surprised. By late August of 39, Maud was making more and more references to the problems in Europe. She wrote, war between Germany and Poland, invading Britain and France seems quite probable. The Germans want to occupy Danzig and have a corridor through Poland. The radio is reporting the news every little while. A tense situation. In September, President Roosevelt spoke over the radio at 10 p.m., a very sensible seeming attitude. The majority of Americans must have agreed with what he said. In May of 41, she wrote, I listened to the president's speech at 10:30 a.m., and it didn't make us feel any easier in our minds. On July 12th, the war came closer to Bethel. We read in this morning's paper that Ashby Tibbetts had been killed in an airplane accident in Canada. He was training in the Canadian RAF. Very sorry for the family. December 7th, 41. We heard over the radio that the Japanese had bombed Honolulu and other places. The beginning of war. The president will call on Congress tomorrow to declare war on Japan. A treacherous move while peace negotiations were being held in Washington. Has aroused the ire of the world. December 8th of 41, war was declared in Congress, about 2 hours after the president's speech, asking him to do so. She writes, we listened to the radio a lot. War news not good. Air raid signals sounded over New York and Boston and other places early in the afternoon, but it was a false alarm. We feel that anything may happen. December 16th, news that Stanley Allen lost his life December 7th at Pearl Harbor received today. People are saddened. About this time, Marjorie got a job in Massachusetts, and she moved to the Boston area. And Maud's diary entries indicate just how much the Farwells missed her weekend trips home with her friend Bea, who obviously was very lively to make sure everybody had a good time. Marjorie met and began seeing Henry Anderson, whom she married in 1946. They moved to Holbrook, Massachusetts, and then to Needham. And while Marjorie did keep in very close touch with her family, with almost daily letters, occasional phone calls, and visits, she obviously had a new life, and her relationship with her parents changed, and her parents clearly missed her. Maud continued to work at the library, which seemed to be increasingly busy. On December 3rd of 42, she reports 70 books went out. She kept up with her church activities, her garden, cleaned her home with her usual enthusiasm, and took on the additional duty of working with the Red Cross, which met every Friday afternoon under the direction of Mrs. Hamlin. Her contribution to, Maud's contribution to the Red Cross, not only included sewing clothing for children, but she knit sweaters. By October of 42, she reports, I've already knit 14 sweaters this year. Her diaries continued to mention the war news. In May of 1942, people had to register for sugar ration cards at the grammar school, with the teachers and their helpers doing the work. On December 4th, Norris Brown left for Fort Devens, and she concludes her Christmas entry with the following, we have had a lovely Christmas, although not forgetting the war and the many suffering from it. When the war finally ended in 1945, and seeing how 1995 is the 50th anniversary of it, might be interesting to read some of her reflections on the ending of the war and Bethel's reaction to it. On August 6th of 1945, the radio reports an atomic bomb dropped on Japan, on Hiroshima. The bomb is said to have more power than 20,000 tons of TNT. August 7th, President Truman says the bomb is the harnessing of the basic power of the universe. The force from which the sun draws its power had been loosed against those who brought the war in the East. A terrifying discovery. August 8th, radio reported tonight that Russia has declared war on Japan. So August 9th, we listened to President Truman's speech after we got in bed. He told about things in Potsdam. August 10th, a few minutes before 8 this morning, we heard over the radio that the Japs had agreed to surrender, according to terms made at Potsdam. In a few minutes, Marjorie called to see if we heard the news. We listened to the news off and on all day. The quarts of beans, one pint of raspberry, big four boxes of raspberry, good day, but quite hot. Life is long. August 11th, war is not over yet. The Allies have told Japan they may keep the emperor, but he must be under the command of the Allies. August 12th, a very warm, humid day. We've been listening all day, hoping to hear. Japan had accepted the surrender terms. Nothing yet at 8:30 p.m. August 13th, didn't do much today but wash, made bread, and pick 10 boxes of raspberries. We listened to the radio most of the day, but no word from Japan. 8:14, another hot, humid day. All day, news was expected of Japan's surrender. At 7 p.m., President Truman announced it. Bells have been ringing everywhere, cars tooting ever since. Radios report that cities have gone wild, although VJ will not come until the papers are signed, which would be aboard a ship in the Pacific. We are listening to the radio most of the time. Marge recalls she didn't get a letter off. August 15th, a holiday for everyone. Stores, gas stations, everything closed. We didn't even try and work. Marjorie came up on the train and went back by bus tonight. Church bells rang all day, noise all day. I went to church in the evening, and she ends with, gasoline restrictions lifted today. The years after the war brought a lot of change to the Farwells. They pretty much continued with the usual activities, but they were both getting older, as were most of their friends. Their good friend George Thompson died in 1952, which was a loss. Incidentally, the Thompsons had to be early pioneers. Every winter, they took a trailer and went to Florida, which I thought was amazing. Camped out, reported there were as many as 40 people in the park. Mert's health began to decline about this time. He apparently had Parkinson's disease and had a great deal of trouble with walking. Mom, however, remained pretty healthy. She worked regularly at the library, walking to and from work as they had to give up their car. She cleaned, gardened, and constantly was doing a lot of knitting. In fact, she knit socks and baby clothes, which Marjorie had placed in Sheridan's, a department store in Quincy, Massachusetts, and which Maud sold on consignment. One of her diary entries reads, received a check from Sheridan's for $18 for one dozen pair of men's socks. However, even with the assistance of many friends, they eventually had to hire people to help them with some of their work around the house. In 1952, Margaret, Albert took off storm windows and asked $1.50 for an hour's work, excavation for him. In May 1953, Mert's condition was such that Maud was spending most of her time caring for him, and she wrote on May 19th, I told Dr. Tibbetts I want to be through at the library on July 1st. She was 81 years old. The Bethel Citizen ran the following article on May 25th, 1953. A special meeting of the trustees of the Bethel Library Association was held at the library Monday. It was voted with great regret to accept the resignation of Mrs. Maud Farwell as librarian. Mrs. Farwell has served the library faithfully and efficiently. It was voted to appoint Mrs. Phyllis Howe as the new librarian. Mrs. Howe asked Maud to work for some of the other workers for the month of July and August, and Maud wrote, I shall like to, but Mert does not approve. She did work the month of July, but on July 30th, she wrote, my last day at the library. Mert objects to me going so much. Mert was very ill. Dr. Boynton came to see him several times a week, but there apparently was not much that could be done. On April 16, 1955, Mert was taken by ambulance to a nursing home, first in Norway and then in Auburn, where Maud was hospitalized in Lewiston for a serious eye infection. On April 28, 1955, Maud's diary entry reads simply, Mert passed away this afternoon. Her next entry, April 30, reads, funeral at 2 p.m. This was the only period in the 30 years that Maud did not write daily entries. She did note on May 18th that M and H, Marjorie Henry, went to Bethel and talked with Leland about buying the house. On May 21st, Marjorie and Edith came about noon to take me to Needham. On June 27th, Maud met with Barbara Leland Brown and papers were passed on the house. And there are virtually no entries at all until the end of October in 1955, when she picked up her old habit of writing something every day. By this time, she was living with Marjorie and Henry in Needham, and she stayed there for the next few years. She remained well, and she stayed very active. She kept up with Bethel happenings, too. She wrote letters back and forth to her friends, and she had a subscription to the Bethel Citizen. Her entries often reflected as much about Bethel as they did her new life. She did walk every day, continued to read avidly, reported on every book she read, what was good, what wasn't. She helped Marjorie with sewing, with cooking, with ironing, and she seemed to go on an endless round of social calls, teas, lunches, shopping, whatever, with Marjorie and her friends. She obviously was included in most of their activities. At any rate, if she was unhappy, there was never a mention of it. She was always upbeat. In fact, there was never really a complaint throughout the diaries of anything that might have been unpleasant for her sad. In the early 60s, she began coming to Bethel for the summer months. She stayed in a room at Hall's house, which is the newly renovated Victorian house on the common next to the gift shop. Apparently, Fred Hall and his wife took in rumors, and she came in the summertime. In November of 1963, Henry retired, and he and Marjorie sold their Needham home and then moved to Cushing, Maine. Maud wrote in her diary, "It is not a convenient place for me to live, so I will go to Hall's for an indefinite stay." On November 30th, she moved back to Bethel into the, as she writes, the little room at the front of the house, Hall's, and it's going to be very nice. Again, she adapted to her circumstances. She went to church regularly, walked each morning, each evening, made and received social calls. She talks about going to see Mrs. Tibbetts and going to call on Norma. She enjoyed watching the children skating on the common and had several keen observations to make about Mollyocket Day events. On August 24th, 1964, she writes, "A good summer day after the much needed rain. I went for a walk after supper, foggy morning. Fred mailed the yellow booties to Marjorie. She wrote that she could place them, and I had some on hand. Democratic convention beginning on TV tonight. Going to bed early. Nothing I care about reading. Finished library book, Strange Wives. Didn't care at all for it." On August 25th, Maud Farwell died at Hall's house. She wrote that the night before. She was 92 years old. Her daughter Marjorie is still alive, as is Henry, her son-in-law, and I believe they're in the nursing home in Topsy. I said that August 24th was the last entry in the diaries. However, on the last page of her 1964 book, the very end, she had her little blank pages, and she would put her accounts and birthdays and whatever. On the last page of 1964, she had a following which indicated that she was certainly looking forward to Christmas, because she had written, "At 92, I chose this simple way to send my wish this holiday. For peace and joy, contentment too, God bless and keep you all year through. This is Maud Farwell, age 92, wishing you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year, too." I thought that was very sweet and dear, and had to include it. The diaries were a treat to read, they really were. I was a little overwhelmed with it at the beginning, but I really got a real feel for this woman. I think she must have been a lovely lady. She was very devoted to her family, her friends, her community, her church. I'm sorry I didn't get a chance to meet her. I know some of you people did. She talked about Mary Keniston going to see her new baby, her twins, which were coming. She talks about Barbara a lot, and I know some of you other people do. If you have anything you'd like to share about her or tell or ask questions, this is the time.
We bought her a car.
Oh, you did?
9,000 miles, and we might pay $900.
Barbara, you told me a nice story about her today. She moved out of her house. About her apron?
Yes. There were these old slate sinks in the kitchen and big set tubs. Now, I was 5 feet 4 inches, and I could not reach down into the set tub. I don't think she was much over 5 feet tall. I don't know how she did her laundry. But the day that she left to go down to Needham, she hung her little apron up on the hook by the sink and said, well, my life here is over.
When she went into the library, she was not only very efficient, she was very, she had a particular contribution. She was, as you say, a very sweet, fine person. The librarian in the 30s, Miss Hamlin, who had been there, was very efficient, but I don't think anyone ever called her sweet, ever. She had been very naturally astringent personality, and she tended to be very superior about people who didn't share her intellectual tastes. Mrs. Fowle was a great change, and she made everyone feel welcome. Mind you, Miss Hamlin had had assistants who had made, who did much more easy to get along with than she, but Mrs. Fowle, as the head librarian, I think, brought to it a particular, well, she just made it an easier place. More people liked to go to the library, and she was much better with children. She was genuinely lovely. And my mother, of course, had very strong feelings on the golf, on the bridge. They didn't play bridge, they played bid whist, which my mother thought was beneath contempt. But they did. That was because Mr. Van didn't like to play bridge. He was Mert's partner, and my father played with Mr. Hanscom. And my mother didn't really like to see Mr. Hanscom won because she said he was always so smug about it. She couldn't stand it when Mr. Van won because he crowed, Mr. Van won. She didn't care whether the doctor won or lost. The doctor was an excellent player, and if he lost tonight, he'd win the next time. So if Mert was really the only one, if Mert won, she enjoyed it, except if it meant that Mr. Van. Anyway, she couldn't win on that situation, but she always liked Mert very much. She said that he